You're listening to the Best Morning Routine Ever podcast, the show that proves no one stumbles upon success ever. With your host, Lou Need. Every Mondays and Thursdays, we deliver cold hard evidence behind the power of a robust morning routine. Get ready to be transformed by the renewal of your mind.
Hello, morning enthusiasts. Welcome to the Best Morning Routine Ever podcast. Today, I have a special guest in the house. I have the honor of introducing Nicole Matthews. Nicole is a recognized leader in the self-producing event arena with over 18 years of event management experience. She is the founder and lifestyle architect of the Henley Company. With the belief that life should be experienced in a big way, Nicole set out to create a company focused on helping clients live the life they want to produce the experiences they want to remember. Nicole founded Henley Company back in 2007 with a long career as a corporate event planner. She has produced a long list of distinguished events for notable corporations, both locally and globally. Nicole is also, if she's not busy enough, she is an adjunct professor at Mesa College in San Diego and an instructor in the University of San Diego Certificate in Event Management Program, where she teaches the generation of event professionals. In the last few years, Nicole has lived her way into the dream of working on global sporting events. She has produced VIP hospitality programs at the Olympics. That was London 2012, Sochi 2014, and Rio in 2016. And also FIFA in Brazil in 2015. And a multitude of Super Bowls. Active in our community, Nicole serves as a board of trustee for the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society of San Diego. Nicole, welcome to the show.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here. I appreciate the time.
Absolutely. I'm so excited you are here. And just having read your bio, you are just phenomenal. You are a servant. You are a leader. You are a boss, a CEO, and have been for years. I'm curious to know why Leukemia and Lymphoma Society of San Diego?
Yeah, so I was introduced to a campaign that the San Diego Leukemia and Lymphoma Society, it's actually a national campaign, but our local chapter runs the campaign as well. There is a 10-week fundraising campaign that they call the Man and Woman of the Year campaign. Mm-hmm. And so they identify community leaders who are willing to take on the challenge of raising as much money as they possibly can in 10 weeks. And then at the end of that, the person who's raised the most money is identified as the man. And then there's a woman of the year. And my affiliation with LLS actually comes through friends of mine through the event industry, colleagues that I've known for many years. Their 2.5-year-old daughter succumbed to AML, which is a very aggressive form of blood cancer. And her name is Hazel. And Hazel was diagnosed at 10 months old with AML. And so when I was invited into LLS as a potential candidate for the Man and Woman of the Year campaign, my only caveat was, if I'm doing this, I have to do it in honor of Hazel. So we created a team called Heroes for Hazel. And sadly, she passed away actually about 2 weeks into my campaign. So that obviously gave us even more motivation for the work that we were doing. And after that 10 weeks, we were able to raise $128,000 in her honor. So LLS has been a cause that's been important to me since 2017. The work I do is really in honor of Hazel. And now I'm pleased to be a member of the Board of Trustees for the San Diego chapter of LLS. So until we find a cure for blood cancer, we continue to fight the good fight every single day.
Oh my God, that is a very touching story.
Yeah.
In honor of Hazel, you truly touched the hearts. You touched my heart. You're touching the hearts of the listeners right now.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's people said to me during the process of like, oh my gosh, isn't it exhausting? Isn't it, you know, it's such a hard, fought battle for 10 weeks, and it's, you know, yes, it was, but it paled so completely compared to what Hazel and her family had to go through. And, you know, she endured 622 days of treatment and, in the end didn't have the result that we had all hoped for. And so, you know, me sacrificing quote 10 weeks of my life to dedicate something to a cause is nothing compared to, what her and her family had to go through. So it was a real honor and privilege to advocate and be her champion. And I have a beautiful picture of her that a friend of mine oil painted. And so I have that in my office. And any moment I need a little more motivation on what, you know, perspective and working hard, I just, you know, take a little glance at my little Hazel. And that's really sort of, you know, inspiration on a daily basis.
Yeah. Thank you for your compassion. Yeah. That it really shows. And then you feel for the family and it's a real thing.
Yeah.
It's a really big deal.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. So.
Thank you for sharing. Uh-huh. Tell us a little bit about your book, because the title of your book is Permission, semicolon, Stop Competing and Start Creating the Life You Want to Live. Because there is no true competition, right? It's only with ourselves.
Absolutely. Yep, absolutely. So I wrote Permission really out of a response to some of the presentations that I was giving. And as you mentioned in my bio, I also am fortunate enough to be an adjunct professor in event management and hospitality. So I have access to a lot of students and I do, you know, a lot of presentations. And so it allows me to be in front of different audiences, you know, on a fairly regular basis. And so I'd be telling my story about starting my business and about creating these opportunities for myself to go work at the Olympics and to self-produce events and kind of all those things that made me look, if you will, fancy on paper, that makes me look like I've had a really great and, you know, a successful career, which I'm very blessed and I've worked hard to have. But everybody has a backstory. Right. And so I didn't want to mislead people to say that I just came flying out of the womb and I suddenly was working at the Olympics and I was owning a, you know, a business. Everybody has a backstory. And so, you know, like many people, I've had bouts of, you know, depression and financial insecurity and self-doubt and self-esteem issues and kind of all those things that can regularly plague people. But I've also found a way to, you know, create a lot of opportunities for myself in spite of all of that. And so I wrote Permission really as a way to provide a roadmap for people who are really at that place in their life where it's like, I'm ready to do something different. I'm ready to really take control of my own life. So I use the word permission because at the end of the day, it really is just about giving yourself permission and feeling valued enough that you deserve those things. You know, you deserve to start your business if that's what makes your heart sing. You deserve to live your dream and work at the Olympics. You deserve to, you know, open a bed and breakfast in Tuscany if that's what is on your heart. You know, you deserve all of those things if you're willing to put in the effort and work for them. But first and foremost, you have to have a real honest conversation with yourself about permission. So, so the book has been out for 5 years now. I'm, you know, starting to sort of noodle on what's next in terms of my writing. But I really hope that I people find inspiration in sort of my own story of the good and the bad and the ugly, and then really use it as an inspiration piece for helping themselves to create, you know, the life that they want to have.
Mm-hmm. So you've been writing for a while because the book came out in 2014.
Yeah, the book actually was written in 6 weeks. So when I set my mind to something, I kind of am like, all right, let's go. Let's raise, you know, $128,000 in 10 weeks. Let's write a book in 6 weeks. Like, so, yes, the book has been out since 2014. But after you sort of write your whole story and kind of put that out into the world, I kind of needed a minute to regroup and get some more life stories under my belt to figure out what the next book is. So there's, you know, it's starting to percolate. I'm, you know, I do writing. That's a bit of a therapy for me. And so I'm excited about sort of, you know, some potential themes for a second book, probably in the next couple of years.
Yeah. I really like what you said earlier about take control of your life and overcoming. And, you know, you as a CEO, as a successful CEO, had to overcome depression, anxiety that, you know, plagues other people, mm-hmm. but you decided to own it. You decided to grab it by the horn and says, you know what? I run this.
Yeah.
You're not going to let, these, emotional distress take over your life. And I want to ask you, when you say permission, are you asking yourself permission? Are you giving yourself permission to feel valued, to feel like you deserve to live your dream, to feel like you're willing to, you deserve your desires. You deserve to live your best life.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in this instance, at least in the title of the book, permission is really used as a sort of rallying cry. And it's also about giving yourself a lot of value. You know, I mean, I can tell you all day long that that's something that you should go do. You should start a business. You should, you know, should. And I talk about the should escalator, right? We all get on this should escalator of our life. And it's like, we just kind of get on and it just takes us, you know, we don't move really. It just sort of takes us to the next place. And, you know, it's easy for me to give you permission, but if you're not in a place where you're ready to receive that and you're really ready to have it resonate with you, you know, it's sort of like the example of like, I can tell you not to be an alcoholic, but until you recognize that you're an alcoholic, you're not going to fix the problem, you know? So it's that example can really transcend, I think, life in general. And so permission is really about allowing yourself to say, I'm now in a place where I feel worthy and I feel confident and I feel deserving of these things, and not in a selfish way where it's like, I just want to, you know, take from the universe, but I'm ready to show up. And I'm ready to put in the work. I mean, there's certainly nothing easy about it. I would love to tell you that, you know, once you give yourself permission, it's like, you know, you're just skating through life, but that's definitely not the case. You still have to show up and work hard every single day. But I think it really, you know, it's that mindset of what am I willing to work hard for? And what do I feel like I deserve? That I think is really what, you know, permission sort of wraps up in a nice bow.
It really is the gateway to providing service to others, mm-hmm. right? Because if you get to a place where you feel valued, like you deserve to open up that business, and you believe it will be successful, you now feel valued in yourself, then there is like no competition, because the only competition is we're creating, as I said earlier, is between you and the person in the mirror.
Yep.
Because if you can create, because your story is going to be different, your desires are going to be unique, your dreams are going to be just very unique to you. And if you are in a place or in a state of mind, if you love yourself enough, you're valued enough, in a state of mind of creation, there truly is no competition there.
True. Absolutely. Completely agree.
So let's talk about your company, because it is a very specific niche. It is your business, event management company.
Yes.
Started in 2007. What are some of the biggest wins you have had this year?
Biggest wins I've had this year. Let's see. I started the year by working at in Atlanta at the Super Bowl. So that was that's always fun. So as the spinoff to working Olympics and FIFA programs, I've also been pretty fortunate in that I've been able to work at, I think this was number 5 or 6 Super Bowl. So that's exciting. And the work that I do in those spaces is VIP hospitality and brand activation for the major event sponsors. So any of the major sponsors for Olympics, for Super Bowl, for FIFA events, that sort of thing. So, so that was a good win when I kicked off the year doing that. I would say I've had the opportunity to travel more this year for work, which I have really loved. And I think a big win is at the place where I can literally just got home on Sunday night from 3 weeks in Europe. And, you know, I think a win is getting to the point where you can be in Europe and your company is still running. Right. And so, you know, wherever my laptop is where my office is. And it's nice to be at a place in my business 12 years in that I don't have to be sitting at my desk every single day, that I can be, you know, in Switzerland, I can be in the UK, I can be in Italy, you know, for the last 3 weeks, and still know that my company is running and I'm, you know, and I still have clients that are being serviced and that kind of thing. So I would say for me this year, that's really been about some big wins. So What makes the Henley Company unique is that we do event management, but we also do personal concierge or lifestyle management as well. So that means we manage the lives of busy executives and their families, in addition to having corporate and nonprofit event clients. And so on that lifestyle management side, we do a lot of travel coordination for our clients. And so that for me has really been kind of fun this year in a very different way. My clients are traveling to unique places and wanting unique experiences. And so that's really, you know, challenging me and my team to put together something that's definitely not run of the mill, you know, where a client wanted to be in France earlier this year. And it's like, you know, everybody can go to the Eiffel Tower, but what else is there kind of thing. So we work really hard on the travel side, and that really makes us unique, because most event management companies don't have the travel coordination or personal concierge piece as well. So I started that in 2007 after a long career as an in-house event planner or marketing manager for a law firm here in San Diego. And I knew that I was not destined to be in corporate America for the rest of my life. So I started little by little growing my business on the side. And then eventually I was able to leave the law firm. And they actually became one of my very first clients when I left in 2007. So being an entrepreneur is the hardest thing you'll ever do. And it's the most rewarding and the most frustrating. And I can only compare it to, I'm sure, having a child. I don't have any children, but having watched a lot of children being reared, mm-hmm. I know they bring you the greatest joy and the biggest frustration. And so the Henley Company is definitely my 12-year-old child that I have.
You started as a side hustle. How big are you now?
So big in terms of staff, I have an assistant who works for me, who manages a lot of my concierge clients, because they actually require me, you know, they want to see a face of somebody. That's not something we can always do virtually. So she assists me with those concierge clients that we have. And then I actually bring in a lot of independent contractors to help on the event production side. So the company kind of ebbs and flows based on what projects we're working on. And I'm totally okay with that. I don't need to run a staff of, 25 people. I like keeping it lean. I like being able to not really be accountable to anybody else. I like the flexibility and freedom to, take my laptop around the world and work from wherever I want to. So it's a lean and mean machine, but it's productive.
That's fantastic. Yeah. Way to stay lean. I did not know you were a 1.5 woman job.
Yes, I know. Some days I think, I dream of, bringing other people in, but with more money, with bigger projects, there's bigger headaches too. So I'm all about like work-life balance, and, travel is incredibly important to me. And so I want to be able to, have the opportunity to continue to travel. I don't want to be strapped to, payroll.
Yeah, I'm so intrigued right now because this is a new development. Tell us about running the business as successfully as you have, solely by yourself as the founder, as the CEO, as the coordinator. And what does it take to actually coordinate with contractors, and what kind of skill sets is required for that?
Yeah. So most of my contractors come, like I said, and because I'm producing a bit, a large scale event, and I need additional people to come in. And I've been in the event industry here in San Diego for, almost 20 years. And so I'm very blessed that I know a lot of really talented people. And it's not uncommon in the event industry for there to be people who are sole proprietors or freelancers. And so they'll work on multiple projects for different companies at the same time. That I have a nice pool of people that I can bring in when I need to. And then, obviously have no obligation to them when there's not, a project that requires them. But the challenges of that, is that somebody might not necessarily know your company culture like they would if they worked in your business every single day. Like any business owner will tell you, it's very rare to find a person who doesn't own the business, who cares about the business at the same level that the owner does. So all the people who I hire and bring on into my team all are, great, kind people, generally speaking. There's been, a few bad apples and lessons learned along the way. But you know, that they care about me and they want the event to be successful. But, you know, at the end of the day, you have to remember that they are independent contractors to you and freelancers. So, you know, so that I think that's probably a challenge is just that, you know, nobody loves the business the way that I love the business. And then, you know, always making sure that you have people who are available to you, because the event industry, you know, you could have a project at the same time that you're, you know, someone else does, and there goes your freelancer, right? They're being freelanced onto another project. So, you know, there's just trials and tribulations that you have to learn as you're running a business. And I, you know, will certainly be the first to tell you that I've made a million mistakes in running a business. And sometimes I'm the one who gets in the way, you know, you get in your own way, and that's never a good thing. But I'm also, I would hope to say that I am a student of business, and I really love to listen to podcasts, and I love to read books, and I love to follow really smart and brilliant people who are doing business, you know, much bigger and better than I am. And, I think that's important too, is it's real easy to be, you know, just one woman behind a laptop trying to create something, but you've got to have a great network of friends that are entrepreneurs who you can bounce ideas off of. You got to constantly be learning about your business, how to run a business, you know, all of that kind of stuff. So, like I said, it's my greatest joy and my biggest frustration at times, because, you know, it doesn't always do what you want it to do.
Mm-hmm. I hear a whole lot of self-development and following others and knowing who to follow, mm-hmm. and self-education. So the podcast and the learning, because success does leave clues.
Yeah.
There's no need to do it on your own or reinvent the wheel. Success leaves a trail. And so I teach that, and I'm the same way. You got to invest in yourself.
Absolutely. And nowadays there's no excuse, because truly you don't have to leave your bed to find the answers that you're looking for. I mean, you know, the gift of Google to our lives is like profound. I mean, you know, you don't even have to go to college and get a 4-year degree anymore to learn everything that you really need to learn about running a business and, you know, getting exposure to things that, I mean, even 10, 15 years ago, we didn't have the opportunity to know and learn. And so, you know, the information is out there. You know, the information can come to you, you know, podcasts, articles, books, whatever it is, websites, whatever, you know, social media, whatever your thing is on how you want to consume information. You just have to be committed to consuming that information, and then not just being a student, but actually being a doer. You know, it's one thing to just keep learning, but at some point you have to actually implement that into your business and use those time and talent that you've invested to making your business grow.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I know the aftermath is you get to enjoy the results.
Uh-huh.
You get to travel the world. I know it says here that you actually met the beloved royals, Will and Kate, in person.
Not in person. So I want to make that very clear. I put together a trip, as an opportunity when they got married. I'm a huge Anglophile and have spent some time living in England. And so when anything royal comes up, I'm definitely the first person to be interested in that. But that's about, you know, creating an event. There wasn't a client who came to us and said, you know, here's what we want to have done. We created, you know, a package that we were able to, you know, show for people if they were interested in going. So, you know, that's always fun. I like to take what's happening in pop culture and sort of in the world in general and figure out, is there a way that we can create an event that is revenue generating for the Henley Company, but also is a super unique experience for the people who are interested in attending. Mm-hmm. So,
and honestly, I really love your niche, the travel aspect of your business. You know, you're an event manager, management company, but then you add a travel that actually diversified your company. Huge.
Yeah. And people, you know, when the internet came into our lives, people said, you know, travel agencies are going to be a dying art. And to some degree, you know, the average traveler who's just doing something on, you know, Southwest Airlines, they can do very easy on a website, doesn't need a travel agent. But the clients that we're serving are not interested in just, you know, a $69 fare on Southwest Airlines for the weekend. I mean, these are people who want to have unique experiences. And you know, I just completed a trip for clients that, as I mentioned before, I went to France, and we had over, I think it was almost 15 hours of, you know, of work that we put in on their behalf. Well, most people don't have 15 hours to spend, you know, putting a trip together and all the parts and pieces and all of that. And so, so I think the travel industry is just sort of redefining itself in spite of the internet. But there's still a lot of interesting work to be done, for an opportunity to serve clients. And so that's the part that really excites me.
Yeah. 15 hours planning a trip sounds exhausting.
Yeah, it is. It is. It's a lot of details.
Tell us about your big why. As a solo entrepreneur running such a huge business and being so successful at it, what is your why? You get to travel the world. That's mm-hmm. a plus. And you talked yeah. earlier about feeling valued and worthy and being able to add value into mm-hmm. the world that and as a byproduct. Tell us about your why and why everyone needs to have one.
Yeah, so I think I would say that I have sort of two whys. And so the first would be like my personal why of why it's important to me to speak on stages and to write books and to give, you know, do podcast interviews and all of that. It's because you know, I grew up in a really blessed family. I, you know, basically Beaver Cleaver. You know, I there was, if you know, from the outside, there was no reason that I should have ever had self-esteem issues. I mean, I have very loving, you know, I do still have very loving parents. I have a very close family. You know, we were very comfortable growing up. We got to see the world. I say all of that to say that even I, you know, have had some very dark days and had self-esteem issues. And I have had to really sort of, you know, dig deep and sort of pick myself up and, you know, show up into the world. And I, at some point along this journey, have said to myself, if that can happen to me, it could probably, and I know does happen to particularly women in situations that aren't as great as the situation that I was born into. And so my why really is about helping women to live their best life. And I know that's pretty cliche, but I want women to live a life that's full of experiences. I want them to create their own opportunities. I want them to be amazing business women, if that's the journey that they're, you know, that their heart wants to take. And if they want to work for someone else, I want them to be the best that they can be in, you know, in that realm too. So my why is really about helping women to create their own opportunities. That's a huge thing for me. And I, you know, love to coach women about how am I going to create an opportunity for myself, either revenue generating or as an opportunity to perhaps meet somebody that I haven't already met that could be a stepping stone for me. And then on the business side, I would say my why is really about creating unique experiences. Again, going back to my beloved family, I grew up in a family where we did monthly family experiences. So I had, at the time, my niece was 6 years old and my dad had just turned 60. And so we had a very big gap of ages in our family. And so the rule was that once a month you were assigned that to do the family experience, and it had to be something that you hadn't already done as a family and it couldn't cost a fortune. And so even my 6 year old niece was responsible for her month and my 60 year old father, you know, the same thing. And so we just really cherish family experiences and things that are unique and different. And I think probably because I've had the travel bug my whole life, having unique experiences just sort of oozes out of me. And so the Henley Company, really our whole why behind the Henley Company is about creating unique experiences and creating stories for people to tell. I want people to either attend an event that we produced or to return from a trip that we crafted for them and have amazing stories to tell, because that's really the fabric of a great life, I think, is when you have stories that you can share and memories that you can laugh about and, you know, lessons that you can learn from and teach others. And so for me, that's really our big why with the Henley Company.
It's really unique because you're taking a childhood experience that you have with your own personal family, right? And then you made a business out of that.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So that's really the underlying theme, I would say. If there's a ribbon that connects everything that we do in both my personal and professional life, it really is about unique experiences.
Fascinating. So now I keep hearing you say you've had to dig deep so you can show up. Now I want to know, what does it take? What's your morning routine? What does it take for you to get up, dress up, and show up in your life on a daily basis to run what you do?
Yeah, thank you. Well, I would love to be able to tell you that I'm up at like 4 a.m. and, you know, just listening to the birds sing and, you know, journaling my heart out, but that's not real. So I'm all about keeping it real. I think for me, my morning routine is really just about kind of getting my mind right. And that in for me is in the form of, I try to always work out in the morning because I just dread doing it in the afternoon. So I like getting it over with in the morning and just that sense of accomplishment. I think there's nothing better than when you hit stop on your stopwatch after you finished a run or you're at the gym and you're like, yes, I get to push end now. So that's always a good, like first, check that one off the list. And then I'm a big list maker. So I always have a list. Usually the night before, I'll make a list of the things that are kind of important for the next day that I need to get done. I like to highlight my list and cross those things off. And then I need some warm-up time in terms of just my own mind. I'm not one who can like, don't fire a million questions at me in the morning. My little brain needs to get up to speed. So I usually take about the first 30 minutes of my day when I finally get to my computer. And I just sort of do a roundup of what's happening in the world. So that's where I go check my social media. I like to read newspapers from, you know, different places. So not only, you know, US news, but I like to read the UK newspapers. You know, I like to just sort of get a sense of the world as well. And so that usually takes me about 30 minutes to kind of get up and going. And then after that, sometimes it's hard to get out of my chair after that, you know, because I'm like, my head's down and I'm doing what I need to get done. So I wish I had like, you know, an amazing that I sit around and I eat, you know, green smoothies and, you know, meditate all morning long. But I do a little bit of that, but I don't do that consistently enough to tell you that that's really my routine. But for me, it's all about getting my mind right in terms of, you know, working out and then just kind of doing that roundup, like I said, so that I can get into my day.
It's beautiful how the morning routine work because it is tailored. It is unique to you and the individual. And believe it or not, you are doing it right because you're getting up and getting your mind right. Right. So you are doing what we call a mind dump the night before. You are preparing for the day ahead. So your morning routine starts the day before, the night before, actually. Yeah. And so it's really fascinating because I'm hearing this quite frequently with the entrepreneurs. And so you are right in alignment with them because they're making a list the night before. They're going over the list in the morning and then they're checking it off. But also getting the mind right is they simply take 10, 15 minutes to actually before welcoming the world, before welcoming the social media. For you, you say, you know, you need to warm up. Your brain needs to warm up. You need 30 minutes to actually catch up. And a lot of entrepreneurs are doing just that. And the workout is key because you're releasing serotonin. You do it because you don't want to do it in the afternoon, but it shows that doctors and psychologists have shown that when you work out in the morning, it helps you sleep better at night.
So
releasing the serotonin first thing in the morning, I do my workout at 6 a.m. as well. And it's crucial because I feel like I've accomplished something. Just like you said, hitting the stopwatch.
Yep.
Like I got the hardest part of my day done. I took care of myself.
Right. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Yep, exactly. It's like at least that's not like looming over you for the rest of the day once you get, you know, through that.
Yeah. And stress management is a lot easier once you've worked out.
Yep. For sure. Yeah, for sure.
So thank you for sharing that. And I don't want to take much more of your time. Go ahead and tell us, how can we connect with you?
Okay, great. So let's see, on social, I have everything for the business is under Henley, H-E-N-L-E-Y-C-O. So Henley Co. That's our handle on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. And then for my sort of speaking writing side, it's Miss M.S. Nicole, N-I-C-O-L-E, Matthews. So Miss Nicole Matthews. So that's on Instagram as well. And then you can always shoot me an email at Nicole at the Henley, H-E-N-L-E-Y, company.com. So Nicole at thehenleycompany.com.
Morning enthusiasts, you've heard it here first. This is Nicole Matthews, and she broke down her whys. Her personal why is to actually help women live their best life and coaching in her teaching as well and through her book. But also her business why came from a very personal touch because it stems from your childhood experiences, your family monthly unique experiences, and that you built a whole business out of it, and you're running a successful business out of it. I love what you talk about in your book about giving yourself permission to actually live and thrive and live your dream, live your life.
Yep. Yeah. Well, I hope that has inspired, some of your listeners, and I would love to continue the conversation if anybody would like it.
Absolutely. I will put your contact information on the show notes below and great. People can reach out to you.
Sounds great.
Nicole, thank you so much for coming on the show.
You're most welcome. I appreciate the opportunity. Thanks so much.
You are very welcome.
All right. Take care.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Well, all right, morning enthusiasts. That's it for today's show. Thank you for tuning in. If you love the Best Morning Routine Ever podcast, we'd love to hear from you. So go ahead and subscribe, rate, and give a review on iTunes or Google Play. While you're at it, tell a friend about the show. Be sure to visit bestmorningroutineever.com and our Facebook group to join the conversation, access the show notes, and discover our fantastic free bonus content. Until next time.